this must be BBC. Yeah. That's encouraging. But we're sowing the seeds of love. Tears of fear, Sam.
Have a good one.
We'll try the videoing, so I might sit on the end.
Who's Tony's coming today?
One piano in this house, and as soon as class is finished, there'll be a scramble to occupy it. You could sometimes reserve it, but often it was just a free-for-all. So I used to crawl through the food hatch sometimes to see if I could beat the others.
Peter and I in particular used to play together. We used to play old soul numbers in the main, Otis Redding stuff, Wilson Pickett, things like Benny King. And I don't know, I always thought Pete had a great voice for that kind of material. I mean, he always wanted to play the piano as well, actually, you know, but I managed to get there first, so I did that.
Am I very wrong to hide behind the glare from an open mind and stare?
And there was a strange character called Peter Gabriel, who was a very placid, very, very ordinary, very quite normal chap, who would just suddenly jump on tables and start singing, which is quite out of character. He was a drummer, in fact, to start with. People don't realise this, but In fact, he lent the Anon of our first... he used to let us borrow his drums, and he used to come along and look extremely nervous.
My drums were my pride and joy, you know, when I was a teenager. It's very strange, because the bass drum from that kit, I've just pulled out again, and it's a small bass drum. It has a really great, very hip sound.
I was banned from playing the guitar throughout my entire career there. I'm not quite sure why. I guess maybe at that stage, pop music was a sort of a symbol for the revolution that was about to overthrow the establishment and bring the country down. It was kind of two camps, actually, me and Ant and Tony and Peter. And we were in rival groups at one point, remember that? We were called the Anon. Tony and Peter had a group called the Garden Wall, who were a bit jazzy. And I thought, we're not really kind of rock and roll, they appear a little bit twee to me.
And Jonathan King was an old boy at the school, and one day on the old boy's day, he tended to like to turn up. So we just thrust a tape on him.
As I got into Cambridge, I started succeeding in music. So I returned here after my first year at Cambridge with a number one hit under my belt, and was approached by this little sprout who I'd never seen before, because you never mix with anyone like a year or two younger than you. And he gave me this tape, so I said, who's it by? And he said, oh, but I haven't got a name yet. So I listened to it foolishly, which was a mistake I would never make in these advanced years, and thought it was absolutely fabulous, because I thought the guy had a great lead voice and there were really interesting songs. So I named them Genesis, recorded them, and I might as well leave now.
Got more and more involved and doing sort of slightly what you might call more typical later Genesis stuff. But he wasn't really into that, and we realised we were losing him. So Peter and I very specifically sat down one day and wrote a song tailor-made to Jonathan King's tastes, and his favourite group at the time were the Bee Gees. So we wrote a sort of Bee Gee pastiche song, you know, which was called The Silent Sun. And he loved it.
The silent sun that never shines. She is the warmth of my lonely heart.
So I did my best Robin Gibb impersonation on one of the demo tapes, and that allowed us through to the next leg, where we thought we could get into the studio. It was all so exciting at that point, and I remember when we first saw an ad in the Record Mirror for Silent Sun, you know, I cut it out and stuck it on my school books. It was a, you know, a big moment.
Baby, you've changed my life. I'm trying to show you.
I still believe that some of those early songs could be smash hits. The Silent Sun particularly is a gorgeous song. A lot of people in those days said it was a bit of a Bee Gees pastiche. Actually, that's totally wrong, because it was really before the Bee Gees and before the Crosby, Stills and Nash thing that they were doing this kind of sound. And I also think Peter's voice was so individual and the lyrics were so different from anything that anyone else was writing. I think if somebody else picked up some of those songs and covered them, they'd have smash hits. They are available through John Joe Music, phone number at your local BBC station.
We needed a name for The Silent Sun. We wanted to put it out as a single. No one had a good idea. Between ourselves, we couldn't agree. One comes to mind, which in fact was one of Ant's ideas, which I think tells us a little about the era, which was The Champagne Meadow. I remember that. So I'm very glad that wasn't it.
I think I've got a soft spot for Jonathan, I think, because looking back, I mean, to make a record now, a single or a few tracks, is not a big deal. In those days, to make an album for a bunch of guys who were at school, sort of 16, 15, 16, 17, and couldn't really play very well, to go in and get a record deal, you know, 3 days to make the album, was actually quite an achievement.
I had this brilliant idea to call it From Genesis to Revelation and not have an artist name on it. This was a terrible mistake, because it got bumped in all the religious bin of all the record shops and nobody ever heard it.
I think a lot of his influence was good. I mean, there's no doubt that some of the tracks we were doing were unwieldy and too naive, but nevertheless, I think that he wanted to turn us into too much of a poppy outfit.
In 1970, Genesis signed to Tony Stratton Smith's Charisma Records. He paid the band a wage of £10 per week and took a very close interest in their career, encouraging Genesis to develop their live act. Tell me my life is about to begin.
Tell me that I'm a hero. By the time we came around to doing Trespass, the second album, we'd done a certain amount of live playing and we'd You know, we'd written loads and loads of material, and the whole idea of the band had completely transformed from being a band that was trying to have a hit single to a band that was trying to do something adventurous musically.
I started getting bad stage fright, which sort of came from nowhere, really. I mean, I'd started off by being pretty confident. In fact, at the start, Peter was the one that used to be really quiet. I mean, it seems extraordinary to think at one stage that one of the roadies was going to have to do the announcements because Pete just couldn't handle it at the beginning. Eventually, I got physically sick. I got bronchial pneumonia, and the doctor advised me to clear out.
We thought that if one of us left, we couldn't carry on. And I reckon the closest we came to busting up was when Anthony left.
I did suggest at the time that we looked for a new drummer because I thought it was important that we ought to try and get a drummer who was kind of equal stature.
We're waiting for you. Come and join us now. We need you with us. Come and join us now.
Remember the first time you met Phil, and what was he like?
Very...
You were going to say cocky, weren't you?
He was cocky. So confident.
I thought this was this is not what I'm used to. I've never been anywhere like this before. And of course, they had the piano, grand piano out on the patio. There was a sunshade for you to put your drums underneath. There was a swimming pool. And I was early, as usual. And one of the guys said, why don't you just go and have a swim? Well, we've got 10 guys ahead of you, so why don't you just go and have a swim? So I went and had a swim. Meanwhile, I was listening to all the other guys audition because it was open air, it was in the back garden. So by the time I came out to do my bit, I knew all the pieces, you know, I knew all the audition pieces. And I waltzed through it.
Where he sat down at the kit, I knew he was a good drummer before he played a note.
I must admit, I'm flattered, but no. I mean, there was, you know, I think little doubt at the end of that session that Phil was the best. I mean, certainly Peter and I felt that. And
the rest was so terrible.
Split decision. When I joined the band, I was kind of the only one that had that didn't have a public school education. I was a grammar school boy. Actually, stage school, really. I mean, I stopped going to grammar school when I was 14 and went to stage school.
Dad, you said I could have a cow of my own. Can I have this one?
Oh, now, hold on. I'm in one of our herd.
You said I could choose.
Yes, you did. That's right, Dad.
So I was kind of class clown, and when I joined the band, there was an awful lot of friction that I guess came from the background that the guys had.
He found himself within a clay not beheld before. Where are you, my father? Give wisdom to your son. And as his strength began to fail, he saw a shimmering lake.
Must have spent a fortune on these 1 and 6 penny ads, you know. So I stuck one in that said, guitarist writer seeks receptive musicians determined to strive beyond existing stagnant music forms. And I thought, well, if that doesn't ring a bell with somebody, you know, I mean, at least I'll get someone who's idealistic, even if they're completely bonkers.
Something in the wording of it that made me curious. You know, a lot of the other guitarists we were coming across were into notes and flash and all that stuff. and Steve was into atmospheres, and that's what attracted us.
I felt, you know, the kind of delicate pastel shading acoustic aspect that the band did was very, very good. But then when the band was supposed to sort of rise into an area of some power, I felt that that was an area that I warmed to, the fact that, you know, there was some aggression in my playing, that I felt I could put that stamp on it in a way.
In 1971, the musically ambitious Nursery Crime was released. It was greeted with indifference by the music press and the public, and Genesis had to accept second best as their stablemates Lindisfarne had a number one hit with Fog on the Tyne. But unexpectedly, Nursery Crime entered the Italian top 10, forging a special relationship between Genesis and their Italian fans that has stretched to this day.
At the time, the album didn't sell particularly well, so it's only in retrospect, or it's only as an archive item, that it became a heavy seller, apart from one territory, which was Italy.
Well, you fucked me with that one.
We like audiences that sit down and listen to the music rather than get drunk and pick up girls and...
Big ones.
Boca de Casina. Kazuna. Kazuki. We like audiences that sit down and listen to us.
And we like the words, the music, the arrangements, all democratic.
Often yes, oh, yes, that's right. Yes, quite often. About 5, 6, or 10 times a week.
And in those days, no one really liked us. Apart from the Italian, so the more time we could spend there, the better. The more we would cheer up.
Fantasy, I think.
Where do you take the inspiration?
Dove trovate l'ispirazione per i vostri testi?
Well, the fantasy often comes.
Quasi sempre l'ispirazione ci viene dall'anima.
So what we do is we check out the reading of the soul.
Di qui, dalla lettura dell'anima che ascoltiamo con un orecchio.
1972 witnessed a turning point in the band's fortunes. Peter Gabriel's bizarre interest in mime and theatrical spectacle was beginning to give Genesis a distinctiveness missing in their earlier years.
I mean, there was some encouragement in the early days. There was a few people who liked us, you know, as I say. And I think really what we were able to bypass a little bit, the fact that we weren't critically very well received, by the fact that I think Peter and his costumes and stuff started to get us a bit of attention, you know. When you first put on these sort of the dresses and foxes' heads and everything, and we suddenly started getting a picture in the paper, you know.
The first gig I remember of that tour was actually in a boxing ring in Dublin. It's not sort of place one would normally expect to go and perform in a red dress, but it was I remember just the moment when I walked out with this costume on, and there was a real sense of shock and horror in the audience, and I thought, oh, this is good. Try a bit more of this.
Watch your lover's skies, what you know.
In order to get the kind of variety of sound we were looking for, it used to take us a very long time to set up between songs. And so we used to, when we first went on stage, we had these sort of embarrassed silences.
And I used to go crazy because everyone would look at me as the front man in these long pauses while these guitarists were sort of endlessly twiddling their tuning devices.
So he'd start to tell stories, you know, which sometimes are totally irrelevant to the song.
Within seconds, the entire clean, green, smooth surface of the park was a mass of dirty, brown, writhing objects. Old Michael continued to rub his flesh into the ground. This time he looked even happier and he whistled a little tune. It went like this. Faster, Phil. This, to us, was perhaps Jerusalem boogie, but to the birds, it meant supper is ready. It's a dream, a terrible vision I have. Sitting beside you, I look into your eyes. As the sound of motor cars fades in the night time, I swear I saw your face change. It didn't seem quite right.
Quite often when you're playing in a university bar, they have not the slightest interest in what these musicians are doing up on the stage, so somehow you've got to get their attention and hold it.
Don't you know our love is true?
Our production budget was about £20 a year, so it was very limited as to what he could do.
A flower.
I think the flower mask had come from watching Bill and Ben, the Flower Pot Men, when I was a kid. And Willow Farm, which was in the centre of Supper's Ready, was somewhere where I just tried to explore this unreal world of English subconscious. Supper's Ready was extremely important to the band because, in a way, that was a sort of centerpiece for our ambitions in terms of writing. Because, you know, whatever else was going on in the visual department, our central interest was always and probably is still the writing, the composition of the music. And that was the most adventurous piece to date.
All tight! Feel your body melt. Up to bone, to back, to left. Out of your beast, out of your beast. You're out of the ball. Back to down, to down, to mom. Mom to be washing, mom to be washing. You're out of the ball. Let me hear you last. Goodness of the hand.
To take you a little further westward, agriculturally speaking, to where the sweet smell of freshly mown grass pervades our hairy nostrils. Snapping off time for the cosmic lawnmower.
The band consolidated their reputation with the release of the lyrical album Selling England by the Pound. A single from the album, I Know What I Like, reached number 17 in the charts, and at last, Genesis seemed to be balancing creative innovation and commercial success.
It's 1 o'clock, time for lunch. Fandy-dandy-day. When the sun beats down and I lie on the bench, I can always hear them talk. There's always been a hassle. Jacob, wake up, you've got the time you look now.
The sense of humour in Genesis was extremely important, particularly to me and I think Phil in some ways, but the tracks Willow Farm, Supper's Ready and Harold the Barrel, I think we're trying to follow the tradition of English absurdist humour. I Know What I Like, too, there was this sense, again, of looking at this of repression in the English psyche. And in the line, you know, me, I'm just a lawnmower. There's a sense of this guy, you know, grabbing hold of this lawnmower and mowing the hell out of the grass.
Sunday night, Mr. Barker called. Listen, son, you're wasting time. There's a picture for you in the fire escape trade. Come to die.
The whole album's kind of mad, really. And it's surreal. Right from the moment where it starts off, where Pete's singing unaccompanied.
Cried the uniform to his true love's eyes. It lies with me, cried the Queen of Maybe, for her merchant eyes, he traded in his prize.
The influence for that was the Labour Party manifesto at the time, which was Selling England by the Pound. And, you know, it was the references are so scattered within that one album and everything, including the album cover painted by a lady called Betty Swanick, who just died recently. There was something about the whole kind of package that always makes me smile.
Selling England by the pound. Citizens of hope and glory, time goes by, is the time of your life. Easy now, sit you down. Chewing through their wimpy dreams, they eat without a sound. Digesting England by the pound. And the land lies down.
Kinds of things come back when you say Land Lies Down Broadway. We did about 98 shows with it all the way across the world. We went to America before the double album had come out. Suicide, we played the whole thing to an audience of people who thought, what the hell's going on? Because Peter was dressing up in extraordinary costumes at this point.
I cringe at certain places now when I look back at it. Again, atmospheres were caught in some of the tracks.
Something's changed, that's not your face, it's mine.
We had these sort of slides behind us. We had three, you know, a triple screen system of slides, which are about 1,000 slides, and they change throughout the show. We did about 100 shows of Lamb Lies Down. I'd say it probably only all worked. Well, it never all worked, actually. It came close to all working on about 4 or 5 occasions, and they were great. Unfortunately, every other night, there was always something wrong.
At the end of The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway, we used to have a little flash, and Peter used to appear one side of the stage, because the whole thing's about a split personality going. So Peter was on one side, and the dummy, dressed the same as Peter, was the other side. And so there was this flash, and the strobe would start, and you weren't quite sure which one was real, you know? Anyway, it was the first gig in Europe, and the mixture of flash powder per ratio to explosion was the first time this guy had done it. And he got too much bang and not enough flash. And the most deafening explosion. We just stopped playing. You know, we just looked around at each other, and the audience was stunned. This guy poked his head around the curtain and said, "Sorry!" And I shouted out, "You're fired!"
End of that tour, suddenly, the lights go up and there's Pete on one stage singing, and he panned to the other side of the stage. And there's a completely naked, big, fat roadie.
That's Jeff Banks, wasn't it?
It's the Willis.
I think it kind of culminated, for me personally, in the Superman costume, though, because at that point, like, I was very much a musician in this band, and this was starting to piss me off a bit. Because Peter wasn't able to get a microphone close enough to his mouth half the time in that costume to actually do what he was supposed to be doing, which was singing, you know.
There's all this big time stuff happening with long tours being planned way in the future. And I just felt I was getting to be part of a machine. And I also felt I was becoming a sort of stereotype, sort of rock star, or falling into wanting that ego gratification. And, you know, I didn't like myself, I didn't like the situation then, and I didn't feel free. I had a call from William Friedkin, who was very sort of hot as a director at that time, just after The Exorcist had come out, and he'd read this little story idea on the back of a live album and liked that and wanted me as a sort of story ideas person for a film project he was trying to do.
It was an opportunity he felt he couldn't turn down, and at the time it just wasn't wrong for us to allow people to do things like that, you know. It just would have been totally wrong. I felt that quite strongly.
My first daughter had just been born, and for a while they didn't think she was going to survive. And it was during the making of The Lamb when the band were in Wales, and I was doing these crazy sort of 5-hour drives through the night, thinking my Hillman Imp, and it was sort of through these I was getting totally exhausted, but for me there was no question about priorities, and that I think pissed off the band too, because I was the first to sort of have a baby. And they, you know, didn't have any understanding how it changes the way you feel.
You know, he grew up perhaps quicker than the rest of us, really, in a sense, at that time. And he wanted a bit more time than we felt we could give. The rest of us were totally committed to it. And so he felt he had to leave, you know. I had long talks with him about it, because obviously we came into the group as sort of like best friends and everything. And him leaving was a big blow to me personally.
His last gig with the band was in Besançon. In France, and it was supposed to be Toulouse, but because of lack of interest, there were no tickets had been sold, so the concert was cancelled. And we were backstage at the dressing room in Toulouse, in Besançon, and someone said, "We're not playing tomorrow night, so this is the last night." And it was a terribly anticlimactic, because we all built up to this last night with Peter, that it was going to be a great show, and suddenly this was going to be the last night. We weren't prepared for it, so he played the last post on the oboe. And we went on stage and did The Lamb. Extraordinary, really. And the light dies down.
Gabriel's successful solo career has been a unique musical exploration. Influenced by American soul and the diverse sounds of African and Latin music, he's become an influential figure in the spread of world sounds. In 1986, he set up Real World Studios, which houses WOMAD, the World of Music, Arts and Dance, an organisation that promotes multicultural arts in the West.
I think the fact of him coming back into Genesis, which I get asked daily when I'm on the road especially, no, I don't think that will ever happen. We could get together for a special one-off, but we haven't and we're not.
Gabriel did rejoin Genesis on one occasion at a special fundraising show for WOMAD at Milton Keynes. In 1982, Gabriel had helped organise the first WOMAD festival at Shepton Mallet with musicians and dancers from 25 countries. It was a critical and artistic success, but a financial disaster.
It looked as if we were going to go bankrupt. There was a lot of pressure. I had sort of threats against my life and people, really nasty phone calls to the family, and it was just a horrible experience. Tony and the band then really proposed this thing to bail me out, so it was a very generous thing, and although, you know, I had no wish really to relive my past or go backwards with Genesis, I was really touched that they were prepared to help out.
It's been a long, long time.
It rained all day long. Actually, my memories about that day are very vague because it was a little bit of a sort of a dream. We hadn't rehearsed enough for the show, really. And I think Pete came on in a coffin, if I remember. But he wasn't wearing a dress. That much I know. I'm actually very pleased we never recorded it or filmed it, because I think for those that were there, it was a great, great evening. But to actually watch it back in the cold light of day, I'm sure there were rough edges and wrong notes and dodgy bits.
It was just a big mud bath out there, but I think the audience were sort of wallowing nostalgia in the same way that we were. So it was musically not as strong as I'd hoped it might be. Didn't quite grab the magic. But it was still a very friendly sort of reunion.